The Lord, God's children, because this is a day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Welcome to the Master's Touch Sunday worship service. You know, we're delighted to be able to bring these worship services to you to glorify God. But let me ask you, did you come today expecting to receive from God? Well, if you didn't come from expecting to receive from God, you won't. So get your expectation level way up there, elevate it real high. Now, as we begin to worship today, take a second to assemble a small piece of bread or cracker and a swallow of some sort of beverage or juice, and then set it aside. Later on, we're going to pray over it, sanctifying it as the body and the blood of Christ. But let's begin by inviting the Holy Spirit to join us in our worship service today. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come into your presence in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. We enter your courts with praise and thanksgiving in our hearts, open wide, expecting to receive your word and revelation knowledge. Our love and our devotion for you is flowing freely from our lips and our hearts. We love you, magnify you, we adore you, we praise your precious holy name. We thank and praise you, Lord, that we believers dwell in the secret place of the Most High, and we thank you that you've already heard our prayers. You know, we rejoice because your word tells us that all of your answers for the believer's prayers are yes and amen, and we thank you for the gifts of utterance, the rhema word of God, revelation knowledge, the logos word, and impartation. We thank you that the healing power of God is present to heal all who come to you in faith and in need. And we give you thanks and praise for your only begotten Son and his finished work on the cross on our behalf. We thank you that we are totally healed, made whole, and completely restored. And we give you all the honor, glory, and praise in the name above all names, the matchless name of our Lord Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. Now, if you don't know these songs that we're about to do, the words, then just listen to the words, let them minister to you as we worship and sing. If you know them, join in.
Every pain, live inside. pastures so green, you lead me beside waters so calm, and you are restoring me. You lead me in paths of your righteousness.
Stop what you're doing, pull up a chair, and get ready to receive. You see, we've entered God's presence with praise and thanksgiving, and now as we dwell in God's presence, just embrace the sweetness of the Holy Spirit. Bask in His presence and open your hearts to receive Him. friends, the power for God's miracles always follows the Word of God, and that's exactly where we're going next, deep into the Word of God. Father, may your words be my words and my words be yours. May the meditations of my heart be wholly acceptable to you, and let your grace and mercy fall on this broadcast right now in your word. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, remember that because we're entering into the throne room of the presence of God, we need to be prepared to be in that presence. And in order to go deeper into the Spirit in worship, we need to use that door then, that soaking worship door, to get into that presence. And that's just what we did. Okay, we're still talking about living in the presence of God. And as we begin today, we're going to look at Psalm 1, verses 1 through 3. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in season, whose leaf shall also not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. Today, women and men and children everywhere are searching for happiness, fulfillment, and love. However, my friends, they're searching in all the wrong places, because peace can only be found in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the person who is saved has God's presence with him. Didn't Jesus say, "I am with you always"? Again, Psalm 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he does shall prosper. Psalm 1 is the introduction to the entire book of Psalms. It's a very important psalm, because you see, the book of Psalms was the Hebrew hymnal. The Bible says, blessed is the man. The person who has God in his life is truly blessed. Now, this word literally means happy, completely satisfied, or blissful. So if you're saved, you have God living inside of you. And we must understand this so that we gain the full meaning of the impact that it has on us. Psalm 16, verse 11. Thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. All right, let me ask you this. If Jesus was with us 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, would your life change? Well, Genesis 28, verse 15 says, I am with thee and will keep thee in all the places whither thou goest. So God is with us. His very name is Emmanuel, which means God with us. Our evidence, Matthew chapter 1, verse 23. Now, the Bible says that if we realize that God is with us, it will radically change our lives. We will have the peace that the world doesn't have. Now, we're going to briefly look at three things that will keep us living in this presence of God. Number one, first, we must depart from sin. 2 Timothy 2, verse 19 says, Nevertheless, the foundation of God stands sure. Having this seal, the Lord knows them that are his. And let everyone that names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Okay, 1 John chapter 3, verses 4 and 5 says, Whoever commits sin transgresses also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. And you know that he was manifest to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Whosoever abides in him sins not. Whosoever sins has not seen him, neither known him. Wow. We have to listen to the counsel of the godly, not the counsel of the ungodly. And this means cutting off from ourselves the means of communication of the world to your heart, like secular movies, rap music, ungodly TV, filthy language and songs, and so on. So the Bible says in Ephesians 4, verse 22, that you put off concerning the former conversation the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lusts. Psalm 101, verse 3 tells us, I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. I hate the work of them that turn aside. It shall not cleave to me. Now we must leave the way of the sinners. And this means you will probably lose friends, and sometimes even your own family may reject you. But Jesus promised to give you 100-fold in this lifetime and in the life to come. Now, I remember when I got saved, I stopped living the way my friends lived, and that doesn't mean I broke off all contact with sinners. In order to do that, I'd have to go to heaven. I just stopped participating in their way of life. As born-again believers, we mustn't participate in any kind of sin, no matter how small we think it is, because remember, there is no degree in sin. Sin is sin, and we are, as believers, supposed to emulate Christ. We're supposed to copy him and his way of functioning here on this earth. But understand this, even if you do fall short in sin, fellowship with God is never again broken. Because when you get born again, you move into Christ and you are in him for all of eternity. You can't come out and your sin is washed away immediately upon repentance. Now, because of this, you will no doubt lose just about all of your worldly friends. But some you will of you will win some of them to the Lord. We have to not fall into the trap of putting our stamp of approval on sinners so as not to offend them or lose them as friends. We have to tell them the truth. They are sinners in need of a Savior, just like you were. That's the only thing that will save them. And no matter what, we must always be honest with sinners, no matter what the consequences are. There's a story of two brothers I recently read. These brothers were rich. They were also wicked. Both lived a wild, unprofitable existence, using their wealth to cover up a dark side of their lives. And on the surface, however, few could have guessed or would have guessed that they were wicked because of these cover-up artists, and they attended the same church almost every Sunday and contributed really large sums of money to various church-related projects. Now, the church called a new pastor in, and a young man who preached the truth with zeal and courage came. He was the new pastor, full of vim and vinegar. Now, before long, attendance had grown so much that the church needed a larger worship center. So, being a man of keen insight and strong integrity, this young pastor had also seen through the hypocritical lifestyles of these two brothers. Suddenly, one of the brothers died, and the young pastor was asked to officiate his funeral. The day before the funeral, the surviving brother pulled the minister aside and handed him an envelope. "There's a check in here that's large enough to pay for the entire new sanctuary," he whispered. "All I ask is one favor. Tell the people at the funeral that he was a saint." The minister gave the brother his word that he would do precisely what he was asked. That afternoon, he deposited the check into the church account. Now, the next day, the young pastor stood before the casket at the funeral service and said with firm conviction, "This man was an ungodly sinner, wicked to the core. He was unfaithful to his wife, hot-tempered with his children, ruthless in his business practices, and a hypocrite at church. But, compared to his brother, he was a saint." I thought that was a good story. Now, we must not linger at the seat of the scornful. This means we must hate the awful condition of those that don't know Christ. We no longer share the same level where they live and understand things, and we have to be aware of the fact that we've been raised with Christ. We are now seated with him in heavenly places. So now we must seek to live that resurrected life and continually point those others to Christ. You know, sometimes we think that we can get real close to the water and not get wet. A colleague of mine in ministry, I'll put it that way, shared this with me a few months ago when he and his wife, Jill, were at Camp Joy for missionary orientation. They decided to go canoeing to the island. Now, usually they got a break after supper before the mass chapel time in the evening. And well, the chapel started at 7 p.m. and it was only about 6. And so he thought that they had plenty of time to go canoeing. So they began to paddle. And of course, he wanted to be the navigator. So he sat in the back of the canoe. The farther they paddled, the island seemed to be getting farther away from them. Before too long, they had to turn back because it was getting to be time for chapel. He told Jill that they had to row fast as they could to get back. Well, the faster they rowed, the wetter they got. They were miserable sitting through the service with their feet all wet. They were sinking. Their boat was leaking. So what I'm telling you is this. If you don't want to get wet, don't get close to the water. And if you don't want to fall into Satan's trap, don't get close to sin. Now that we've seen the negative side of the presence of God, we have to depart from sin. So let's look at the positive side. We must delight in God. Now, my friends, God is our passion. What we delight in is our passion. All right. So there are those who more than anything love sports or music, or they love something else, whatever. It doesn't matter what it is. Our first love should be the Lord. Our life should revolve around him. Paul said in Philippians 3, verse 10, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. Now, we ought to put down the TV remote and pick up our Bible just once in a while, okay? One day, a preacher from a church came to visit a colleague in ministry of mine when she was a child. this happened, and her mom stood at the door talking to the preacher for a long time. And my colleague said that her mom, if she was a Christian, was a carnal Christian. And the t-shirt her mom was wearing reflected that. It had some carnal saying on it, and she said that her mom didn't realize it. And after she was finished talking with the pastor, one of her sisters told her about the shirt she was wearing. She said her mom was so totally embarrassed. But, you see, God wasn't her passion. Whatever your passion is will come through to the surface of your life. Matthew 6, verse 21 says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." God is our point of focus, folks. The world knows this principle. That's why the television, the radio, and the newspaper are so interesting. The world wants you to be concentrating on it. But the Bible says that we should meditate on the law of the Lord day and night. Now, that doesn't mean the Ten Commandments. Every time we turn around, the world wants our attention. Travel down any highway and you'll see a billboard. We have to put the Word of God constantly before us. We must concentrate on it. God is our provider. And the Bible says that we will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. If we are living in God's presence, my friends, He becomes our nourishment, the source of our power, source of our supply. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. He is the vine. We are the branches." He will see us through everything, no matter what the consequences, no what the circumstances. Why? Well, Philippians 2:13 says, "For it is God which works in you both to will and to do His good pleasure." So we can do anything if God's presence is with us, even a martyr's death. Thomas Hawk put up his hands as a signal that the martyr's death was endurable. Now, finally, we must do God's will. If we're living in God's presence, we'll depart from sin. Delight in God and you'll know, well, guess what? We'll be doing what God wants us to do. Plus, the most astounding thing is that it's what we'll want to do as well. I mean, we're going to want to do it. Doesn't that sound weird? Psalm 37, verse 4 says, "Delight yourself also in the Lord, and He shall give you the desires of your heart." You see, we are firmly planted in God's will. This is God's work. You didn't save yourself. We are saved by grace, not works. And since God planted us in His will, we can never be removed from the presence of God. We have eternal life. John 10:27 says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand." You see, we are productive in God's will. That brings forth His fruit in season. Okay, when you enter God's presence, you don't leave empty-handed. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says this, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new." So when God comes into your life, you can't remain the same person. You are completely new in Christ. We can't do it. We must let God produce the fruit in our lives through prayer and Bible study. Now, we think of men like Hudson Taylor and we see 50 million Christians today in China. But you see, it wasn't him who was productive, it was God. Taylor said, "The sun hasn't risen all these years that I've been in China without me being on my knees in prayer." Oh, that we could say that, friends, and be productive in the presence of God. One of the things you'll see happen is this. We are prosperous in God's will. "His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he does shall prosper." There is nothing that God cannot do through you. I didn't say that you can do. I said that God can do. Ephesians 3:20-21 says, "Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all the ages, world without end. Amen." God is in us. All we have to do is depart from sin, delight in him, and do his will. We are in his presence. We just need to realize it and recognize it. So we can see then that there is no single subject in spiritual literature that's more highly recommended or insisted upon as more indispensable than the spirit of recollection, or living in God's presence. There's no question about its fundamental role. The important thing is, how do we grow or develop in this living in God's presence? Well, let's take a look at what it means to live in God's presence with our minds, or in our mentality or intellect. Then, what do I mean by saying we must live in that same presence with our wills or volitionally? What does it mean to cultivate this presence of God? Whatever else the spiritual life is, it's practice and more practice. We don't become spiritual by reading books about it. Since God is spirit, And since we are spiritual, precisely because we have a mind and a will, whatever this practice of living in God's presence means, somehow it must mean being united with Him by the two arms of our spirit, which are mind and will. So what again is presence? Well, as you know, in language like English, over 300 million people speak English, and most of those over 300 million are not Catholic, and many are not Christian. So the vocabulary becomes what the people of that culture make it. Words, verbally and semantically, really mean the same thing, but the meaning attached to the words depends on the people who use them. It's therefore of more than passing importance, my friends, to get behind the sense of the words, to see what we mean when we use the words that are so commonplace in our spiritual life here. Presence always describes a relationship between people. Now, I could say by an extension of language, I could say that a desk is present to me or I am present to it, but that wouldn't actually be correct. We're not precisely present to stones or trees, nor are they to us, in spite of what the poets say. Okay, but furthermore, when we speak of presence and we imply that two or more people are somehow present to one another, it makes a big difference whom we're speaking of as being present to whom, whether it's A present to B or B present to A, because A can be present to B and B might not be present to A. I mean, I can talk to you and you're not with me. You may be there physically with me, but you may not be with me. So the deepest mysteries of our faith are simple, but words can complicate them. Okay, so it's true that we're always present to God, right? Yes, God must sustain us, so surely we must be present to Him. So is it also true that God is always present to us physically as the omnipresent divine reality? Yes, He's always present to us by His infinity, or as I prefer to say, physically, because the reality of God is always affecting or influencing us. Now, admitting that God is always present to us physically, then He is always, is He always present to us spiritually? That's the next question. Is God always present to us spiritually, even though physically He's with us? No. No more than a person who is physically next to us in a room is present to us spiritually, unless or until we somehow respond to his or her being there. So a person may be physically present in a room, but unless we're somehow aware of that person being there and respond to that presence, he or she might just as well not be there. It's this spiritual presence of God that is the subject that we've been talking about week after week after week. So we must take time to think of God. What does it mean to live in God's presence in this spiritual sense, unless we first make up our minds to take time out to think of Him? And nobody, not even God, will make up our mind for us. So what does it mean to have someone present to us in this mental sense? Doesn't it mean that before everything else, that the person is on our minds? In the deepest sense, space and time are irrelevant to it, because we are talking about spirit being present to spirit, so it's immaterial. That's what spirit is, the reality which is independent of space and time. A person may be in Texas and another in Southeast Asia, or the one present to us may be long since dead, that is, dead in body, not spirit. And centuries may even separate us from that person, but no matter, because by the mysterious alchemy of the spirit, the moment we begin thinking of him or her, keep in mind that we have to begin thinking about them, they become literally present to us. Now, I don't mean that the spirit of a ghost of a person comes to us. Their presence is revitalized in our minds and in our remembrance. In fact, the person may be physically in our presence, but unless we're thinking about them in that spiritual sense, they're completely absent. So if then we wish to cultivate living in the presence of God, we must set our minds to think about God. We must place him before the eyes of our mind, and this God will not obtrude himself. We must look at him with the power of our mental reflection enlightened by faith. You know, one of the things that I teach my students is that if you imagine that Jesus is with you continually physically, in your presence, and you talk to him and you share things with him while you're driving the car and you're by yourself there in the car, you're not really by yourself. Jesus is with you. Put him in the passenger seat. Talk to him. Share your innermost desires, your innermost feelings with him. He'll answer you. So there's all the difference in the world between a person being here and our seeing that person. And there's even a difference between seeing and looking at the person. We must first look at God with our principal purpose to see God, then see him with that strange power we have of recalling people we want to think about. One of the privileges we have is that if we want to, we will. However, if we don't want to, then again, we won't. So it's the power we have over these minds of ours to direct them to think on whom it is that we wish to think about. And if we want to, we can forget. Some people have the ability to turn their thoughts easily and almost instinctively towards God. Others, not so much. The essence of the contemplative life isn't the great ability in turning towards God. That's not what makes it contemplative. What makes it contemplative is turning one's mind towards God, whether it's easy or not. This is the basis of everything else. Of course, it demands some effort, and especially effort to stop thinking about other things than God. But we need to take every occasion to use or even create situations for being thoughtful of God, where our thoughts are full of God. And that's what I'm talking about when I say put Jesus in the passenger seat with you. What we have to convince ourselves of is that we have the power of turning our minds to what we want. The creating of occasions to become full of thoughts of God is the fundamental principle operative in spiritual reading. Now, what's the difference between spiritual reading and reading things which are not spiritual? Well, the nature of spiritual reading is that in what we read, it reminds us of God, puts us in that mindset, brings us over into his presence, so that we can see the workings of God. This is also the purpose of sacred images, pictures, statues, and crucifixes. Now, this is the purpose of liturgical ritual and of religious symbolism, right down to the cut of the vestments and the color for different liturgical days, which we see all of these in gigantic proportions in the religious sects of today. It's the fundamental reason in God's providence for external gestures and words, posture and position. In times of prayer, you know, it's prevalent and is the whole purpose for creating these kinds of occasions, so that we will be surrounded and literally immersed in religious symbols, which will remind us of God. This is so basic that if we wish to foster living in God's presence, we must make sure that he first comes to our attention outside of the mind, outside of the reminders, in order that he will enter inside the mind. If you follow me, while it's possible to think of God without external reminders of God, it becomes increasingly difficult, and among other things, is one of the main reasons for wearing the religious habit, if you will. As one religious minister told me, when I began to wear secular clothes, I began to feel like a secular. When I began to think like a secular, and now I'm afraid I'm beginning to act like a secular. Well, this isn't trivial. It may sound trivial, but it's not. All of this malarkey is intended that we would be thoughtful of God. Because of these stimuli, the sensations that we experience outside of us will be pretty much the measure of the kind of thoughts we'll have inside of us. So, if we're letting the world affect us and our thoughts, and we're not putting God thoughts in our mind by choice, okay, then we're going to operate in this of the world kind of mentality. If we want God-like thoughts, we have to have God-like experiences. We must see and hear and touch and even, as in flowers and incense, smell God-like things in order to have God-like thoughts. Okay, what then does it mean to live in God's presence mentally? It means to have him in mind. What is living in God's presence volitionally? Clearly, just thinking about God isn't yet living in God's presence in the way in which we know we should. As Christians, not to say religious, okay? Because I don't want to say religious. I'm talking about a fully full-blown, completely immersed in God Christian, born-again believer. Now, God must also, and especially, be in our wills. Here we have Christ's own formula for cultivating this presence of God. Look, at the Last Supper, among other things, he said this, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word," meaning he will do my will. "And my Father will love him, and we shall come to him and make our home with him." The if is up to us always. Of course, with God's grace, the and, in this case, is up to God. We take care of the if, and he'll take care of the and. If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. "And my Father will love him, and we shall come to him and make our home with him." Now, in this passage from Christ's homily at the Last Supper, we see it's the perfect method for living in God's presence with our wills, with the assured guarantee of his responsive dwelling in our hearts. So it means simply and unequivocally that we try, as far as possible, always to say yes to God's will in our lives. How hard is that? Well, it's pretty hard to put into practice. You see, when we're tired and there's work to be done, what do? Well, we just have to do it. We shoulder the burden and we just go do it, don't we? When we're worried and uncertain about the outcome, we may have tried it before and failed, but we're sure it's God's will. We just do it. Now, at times, we can't understand why something's happened to us or to those we love, but even in those trying times and confusing cases, we must say, "Thy will be done." Every time we unite ourselves in will to resign ourselves to the will of God, where the yes may be very reluctant on our parts, or every time we carry into effect God's will by doing it, we are living in His presence. By that strongest of all presences, the union of love, where both lover and beloved have the same will. In this case, His will becomes our will. No wonder Christ promises those who keep His word that the Father will love Him, and we, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, shall come to Him and make our home with Him. When are you at home? When you belong? When you feel you belong? So too with God. If we can use human language, He's made to feel He belongs. And when you're taken for granted, you can relax your home. We touch then on the heart of our subject, right there, when we say this. God will do His part. He will make His home with us. Now the trouble is, we expect something or nothing. So we read books of St. John the Cross, of the Cross, or St. Paul of the Cross, or of St. Teresa of Avila, for some of you Catholics out there. And then there's a myriad of other sainted believers that we read about, and we almost envy the experiences, the intimacy with God that they evidently had, with ease. Listen, friends, God is a hard bargainer. Of course He will give us intimacy. We know enough about the spiritual life to know that the subjective or psychological awareness of God's presence is not necessarily a sign of deep understanding. Nevertheless, this deep sense of intimacy with God's indwelling isn't something we can acquire cheaply. These are costly graces, my friends. If we wish to experience them, we have to do our part. Carry the cross. If we do this, He will do His part. We give Him our wills, and He gives us intimacy and His presence, as only God can, making His home in our souls, and He then brings that resurrection life and ignites it. So how do we live in God's presence practically? Is there some practical rule for growing in the presence of God? How do we do it? As we make progress from glory to level of glory, living in the presence of God, the better we learn to live less and less in the presence of self. So there's all kinds of ways you can divide the human race. The men and the women, the rich and the poor, the literate and illiterate, the Christian and non-Christian. We can also divide the world into two parts, those who spend most of their time living in the presence of self, and those who try as much as possible to live in the presence of God. We hear much about the function of grace as given to us by God in order to carry out His will. That's undoubtedly one of the purposes of grace. But the role of grace isn't only that we might do God's will, but that we might enjoy doing it. How? By sensing down deep in the recesses of our souls, those very little dark pits that are there, that He is with us. This sense of God being with us is His gift, on one condition, that we try to be with Him. Living, then, in God's presence is the joy that He gives us in this life, as a foretaste of the joys in store for us when all effort and struggle will cease, and only peace and agape love will be had. You see, heaven is living in God's presence effortlessly. Right now, if you desire to come into and dwell in effortlessly the miraculous presence of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, if you desire to be in Christ and avail yourself of His marvelous wisdom and power, then you must give your life to Him. It's very simple, pain-free, and in just a moment, I'm going to give you that opportunity.
Love came for me.
Beloved, to come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, repent in your heart from all sin and receive Christ as you repeat this prayer. Lord Jesus, I come to you as a sinner and surrender my life to you. I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you died for me and set me free for all eternity from all my sin. I believe that you rose from the dead and sit at the right hand of God the Father. Take over my life and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. I renounce the devil and all sin. Lord, I receive from you the gift of righteousness, total forgiveness of all my sins, past, present, and future, divine health, wholeness, and restoration, your protection, direction, your provision, your peace, and the gift of everlasting life. I'm yours. Come into my heart and take over my life. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer with me, you're saved. Welcome to the family of God. Rejoice.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us. Promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. And so we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of a bonds of peace around the table of the King. The body of our Savior Jesus Christ tore for you. Eat and remember the wounds that heal, the death that brings us life, paid the price. to make us one. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of love around the table of the King.
Of our bodies and minds. Now, the issue with those who take Holy Communion and don't receive their healing through it, that issue is rooted in lack of knowledge. We must prepare before taking Holy Communion, my friends, and the first thing that we absolutely must do is discern the body of Christ. That means that we have to acknowledge that the bread or whatever you're using as the body of Christ is the vibrancy of the life of Jesus, his supernatural healing and wholeness, that because of his body and blood, you supernaturally have become bone of Jesus's bone and flesh of Jesus's flesh, that you are now filled with his perfection and power, completely healed, completely made whole, completely restored to divine health and wholeness. You can think of it as a pill that's glowing with the Shekinah glory of God. It's healing you as it travels through your mouth and down into your body. And as it goes, it's pushing out all darkness, which is sickness and disease, and it's doing it from the inside out. Now visualize the sickness or disease being on Jesus' body. Put whatever the ailments are on him. Use your imagination. You're not giving him something he doesn't want. Remember, he already took it at the cross. You see, the enemy's trying to trick you. He's trying to trick you into taking the sickness or disease. How? By deceiving you into thinking that you've got it through lying symptoms. But since Jesus already took it at the cross, you're already healed and made whole. So put that lying symptom back on Jesus, right in the same place on him you've been afflicted. In other words, see yourself with the solution. See yourself without the problem. This is called spiritual visualization. It's vital you understand it and do it. The next thing we do in preparation is discern the blood of Christ. We discern it as the forgiveness of all sin, past, present, and future. As restoration of the blessing to your life, the power and the authority of God in your life in full operation. Wow. As receiving God's provision and protection, as receiving the gift of righteousness from Jesus Christ, thanking God for his plan of redemption and that you've been included in it. Thank you that you've been given eternal life, life everlasting, and now that you no longer live under the law, you're living under his grace. Now, lift up the elements of the covenant that I called for at the beginning of the program for you to assemble, and lift them up before the Lord as I pray. Father, we praise you and worship you with these elements of the covenant. We thank you that your only begotten Son, Jesus, gave his life sacrificially so that we may live and have life more abundantly. We thank you now as this bread becomes our portion of his healing body and the vibrancy of his life within us. We thank you that as we partake of the body of Christ, we become healed, made whole, and completely and totally restored. We thank you that this beverage becomes our portion of his cleansing blood, that we're continually washed in the waterfall of his blood and renewed within as we continually remember his act of love on the cross on our behalf. In the name above all names, the matchless name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. Now, the Lord's Supper, my friends, is a personal fellowship. It's a partnership with Christ. Partaking of one bread creates partnership between the members, the disciples, as well, and it merges us into one body, the church. Now, the Word of God commands us to eat the bread and drink the cup. Continually take the bread, give thanks, break it, and eat it. Then take the cup, give thanks, and drink it, all in the remembrance of Jesus. The Lord commanded that the supper be repeated often. However, Paul doesn't give us instruction as to how frequently the Lord's Supper is to be celebrated. He does imply, though, that it's to be done with frequency so that partaking of the Lord's Supper continually recalls to our mind our redemption by Christ from all sickness, all disease, and all sin. So, my friends, do it as often as you want to and need to. As we are instructed, we discern the body and the blood of Christ as we prepare to partake. On the night that he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we thank you that this bread has become the healing body of our Lord Jesus the Christ. Body of our Lord Jesus, broken for you so that every cell, tissue, organ, and bone, all systems, neurological, blood vascular, lymphatic, muscular, skeletal, all systems are totally aligned with God's word and his will. That you are and remain healed, made whole, and totally restored to divine health and wholeness. In the name of Jesus, our healer, the Christ, we pray. Amen. Partake of the body of our Lord and Savior. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Father, we thank you that this beverage has become the precious saving blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. The blood of our Lord Jesus shed for you in celebration of the finished work of Jesus on the cross for the remission of all of your sins, past, present, and future. In the name of Jesus, our Redeemer and Savior, the Christ, we pray. Amen. Partake of the blood of our Lord and Savior. My friends, the Lord's Supper is a feast. It's a feast in union with the living believers and the Savior, whereby we spiritually and by faith receive Christ with all of his benefits and are nourished with the vibrancy of his life into eternal life. And for that, we're eternally grateful. You know, we always want to give you the opportunity to give to the Lord. So today, for those who have tithes and offerings that you are sending out to the Lord, remember this. God is able to make all grace, every favor, and earthly blessing abound to you in abundance. Now lift up your tithes and offerings before the Lord and declare with me, Lord, I thank you that you are my source, that you give me every good thing, and you give it to me in abundance. I lack for nothing, and I never run out, because I walk in the blessing. I expect the fruit of the blessing to manifest the glory of God in my life. Because of my covenant with you, I decree today that I expect a hundredfold return on my offering. And on my tithe, I expect you to open up the windows of heaven and pour me out a blessing that I cannot contain. It is written in your word, and I believe it, and I receive it right now. Lord, I prosper, even as my soul prospers, and my cup runneth over. In the name of Jesus, whom I know is my supplier, I pray. Amen. Now, one more thing. When we receive Jesus as Lord and Savior, the Bible tells us that we are made a new creation or new creature in Christ Jesus. The emphasis, my friends, is on the in Christ Jesus. When we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we move into Christ. He surrounds us completely. We are blended together in Him. We are inseparable from Jesus. In Genesis chapter 2, it tells us about God creating Eve from a rib that He took from Adam's side. And in verse 23, it tells us this. Adam said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man." This is referenced in our being born again. When we are born again, we are born out of Jesus Christ, or through Jesus Christ, and we are a new creation, a new species. As born-again believers, we are now bone of Jesus' bones and flesh of Jesus' flesh. We are completely blended and infused with Jesus. We are inseparable from Him. Think about this. Every cell of your body that makes you up is now contains Jesus' DNA and your DNA merged together. He's part and parcel of your DNA, and you're part and parcel of His. You could think of it like a suit of clothes to get a picture, a mental picture going. Your hands are inside of His hands like gloves, your arms in His arms like sleeves of a coat, your body in His body like a shirt, and your legs in His like trousers, and your feet in His feet. Wherever you go, He goes. Wherever He goes, you go. Now, as a result of this union, all the vibrancy of His life, all of His divine health and wholeness, all of His perfection and provision are yours. He's in you and you're in Him. We've also been given the mind of Christ. Your head goes into Christ's head, and now that marvelous, glorious mind of Christ is available in you to activate and use. Think about this. A caterpillar moves into a chrysalis, and a great exchange takes place supernaturally. What happens? He comes out as a butterfly. He will never be a caterpillar again. For the rest of his life, he'll remain a butterfly. Well, my friends, we too make a great exchange. As I've said, when we accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, we move into Christ. Now, the Bible says that we are now a new creation in Christ Jesus. The result of that new birth is that we remain in Christ for all of eternity. We're carried completely in Christ. Therefore, nothing evil can ever touch us. We can't be sick. Oh, sickness and disease can be offered to us. The enemy can try to get us to take it. How? By coming into agreement with it. Since Jesus went to the cross and triumphed over Satan, the devil no longer has any influence over you. The only thing that he can do since then is distract you, move your focus off the things of God onto the cares of this world. He's a master at it, too. And he can deceive you. He's the father of all lies, and he's very cunning in his deceptions. But here's the reality of it. Satan will always attack you where you lack knowledge of God's word. So if you lack knowledge of what God says about your healing, Satan will attack you in your health. If you lack knowledge of Christian finance, Satan's going to attack you in your finances. His game plan is always the same, distraction and deception. So he can't give you anything. He has no power over you. Listen closely to this. The only thing he can do is offer it to you. That's right. He can only offer it to you. You make the choice in your response. What do I mean by that? Well, do you accept the evil report, receive the sickness and disease or lack by agreeing with what the enemy says about you? Or do you acknowledge the facts, knowing that facts are in the natural and temporary, they have a beginning and they have an end, and therefore they're subject to change, and agree only then with what God's word and promises say about you? Well, I know you're saying to yourself, yeah, but I'm sick and I'm in pain. Well, that may be the case, my friend, but those are just lying symptoms. You see, the enemy always works from the outside in. God always works from the inside out. Now, where God is, the enemy can't be. We're not denying the symptoms. We're denying their right to be there. Now that we are in Christ, we're totally protected because we are in Christ. 1 John chapter 4, verse 17 tells us that as Jesus is, so are we in this world. Well, how is Jesus? He's perfect, full of divine health and wholeness, full of the vibrancy of life, able to do miracles, full of confidence in God and in His word and in himself and what he's able to accomplish for God. Now, beloved, as Jesus is, so are we in this world. Hallelujah, that belongs to you. Every morning, first thing, begin your day by thanking God for the finished work of Jesus on the cross and thank Him that you're in Christ. Throughout the day, as you think of it, give God glory for all He has already done for you. And again, thank Him that you're in Christ. At night, before you retire, give God thanks again for all He's done as your Savior for you. And thank Him for the power of God that's in your body coming against all attacks of the devil, keeping you healed and whole and well. And thank Him again that you dwell in the secret place of the Most High in Christ Jesus. Now raise your hands for the blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift His countenance upon you and give you His peace. May you open up your mouth and continually declare who you are in Christ Jesus, thanking God for all that you have received, and give honor, glory, and praise to the Lord Most High. May you glorify God with all of your thoughts, words, and deeds as the Lord continually blesses you with divine health and wholeness and makes your way prosperous as you walk in His love. My friends, go in peace and in God's blessing.